a center of excellence, a nurturing space for innovation, creativity, and academic freedom. This is the University of the Philippines Los Baños. As a constituent university of the University of the Philippines system, UPLB is a leading national higher education and research institution in various niche areas. Grounding itself on the needs of national development, UPLB cultivates well-rounded and critical leaders who are ready to lead breakthroughs and innovations. Through its industrial and academic partnerships, UPLB propagates its gains to advance inclusive development in various sectors. An educational institution that upholds honor, excellence, and public service.
Are you afraid of public speaking? Do you experience stage fright, like stuttering, racing heartbeat, sweating palms, and trembling knees when you have to deliver an important speech? And do you want to overcome that fear? Then we have good news for you. You are in the right space. Stay tuned in for this two-hour webinar tonight, and let's get started in making you a better speaker. Happy, happy Saturday, everyone. Today is November 12, 2022, and welcome to Bridging Cultures, One Speech at a Time, a Master Speaker webinar featuring 2022 Toastmasters World Champion of Public Speaking, Cyril Jr. Dim. This event is brought to you by Los Baños Toastmasters Club of Division K, District 75, and the UPLB Learning Resource Center. A blessed evening, morning, or afternoon to everyone joining us in this webinar from around the globe via Zoom and Facebook Live. Wherever you are, please let us know where you're tuning in right now. Comment on our Facebook Live comment section below or use our Zoom chat box. How are you doing today so far? Are you excited for this event? Have you had your dinner, breakfast, or lunch? You can type your answers in our chat box or let us see your emojis and how you're feeling today. Let me see your emojis. Is there a heart there? Smiley? Please let us know. Wow, fantastic day, everyone. Stephanie Velasco, good evening. All right, keep coming. Keep them coming, your comments. All right, thank you so much for answering my question. We hope you're all set for today's webinar so we can learn everything we can in this once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. This is the first event that hashtag Team LRC together with Toastmasters is doing a Zoom webinar format that is free and open to all participants. Only those who are part of the panel can turn on their microphones and cameras, but later during the question and answer portion, you may be given access to do so if you wish to speak or ask a question. Once again, if the Zoom has reached its maximum capacity, please join us via Facebook live streaming. We already have 200 plus viewers there. Quickly go to our Facebook page or search for UPLB Learning Resource Center. And together, let's learn how to overcome our fear of public speaking from no less than the best in the world. So if your friends still need to log in, please remind them to join and hop in. Tag them on our Facebook Live video. Share the video as well. Share the Zoom link of our webinar because this is free and open to all. All right, so I hope we're all on board. Time check. It's already 6:10 in the evening here in the Philippines. Welcome to the Bridging Cultures, One Speech at a Time, a master speaker webinar featuring 2022 Toastmasters World Champion of Public Speaking, Cyril Junior Dim. As of today, we have a total of 2,820 registered participants. My name is Cheryl Hermosa Ebron, University Extension Associate and Training Coordinator of UPLB Learning Resource Center and a Los Baños Toastmasters Club as well, or a Los Baños Toastmasters Club member as well. And I will be your event host this evening. Just a few friendly reminders for our webinar. First, at all times, please keep your comments helpful and considerate to the speaker, moderator, and to your fellow participants. Second, if you have questions, write them down below our comment section and make sure that those are relevant to the topic for this evening. And then third, kindly keep your microphones on mute and videos turned off unless recognized to speak. And lastly, please remember to answer the evaluation form after the webinar to receive your e-certificate of attendance. Our team will deeply appreciate your comments and suggestions. Now, for those who will not be able to join us today because you have equally important matters to attend to, don't worry. You can always watch the replay of our sessions on our Facebook page. We now have 105,000 strong followers. Again, thank you for your continuous and overwhelming support. It is our inspiration to keep moving forward. So thank you so much from the bottom of our hearts. Likewise, you can also watch the recorded session on our YouTube channel. We now have a total of 3,340 subscribers there. So please continue to like, share, and subscribe. Now, when sharing this event, guys, please use our official hashtags for this webinar. That is hashtag Bridging Cultures and hashtag Team LRC Toastmasters. That's for easier reference when searching for this video. And to officially start our program, to give her opening remarks, please welcome in the Zoom space the indefatigable and dedicated Area 2 Director of Division K District 75, Toastmaster Juan C. Inyon.
Good evening, distinguished Toastmasters, our fellow Toastmasters, and of course, our guests. In our everyday lives, we wake up and face people from all walks of life, be it our colleagues, friends, family, and strangers. And not all have the skill or the confidence to engage different people from different backgrounds or culture. Speaking to an unfamiliar audience can be intimidating, and many people struggle with it. But this does not mean we cannot learn the art of speaking or relating to others. Public speaking is one of the soft skills that requires the ability to relate and engage with an audience with enthusiasm and requires excellent communication skills. I welcome everyone and congratulate you for joining this event. Here, we will learn some tricks and tips on how we can find our voice and start connecting with people. We don't have to rush. Let's take it one step at a time. And in no time, we have built that bridge that connects us to different culture. Back to you, Toastmaster of the day.
Thank you so much, Toastmaster Joanne. Next up, let's hear some inspirational messages from exemplary and legendary leaders of Team LRC and Toastmasters. Let's hear it from the District 75 Director, Distinguished Toastmaster Jasmine I. Encarnacion. Distinguished Toastmaster Jasmine, good evening.
Thank you so much, Toastmaster Cyril. Distinguished guests and fellow leaders, good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you are in the world. It's truly an honor and privilege to have with us today Cyril Junior Tim, 2022 World Champion of Public Speaking. I have witnessed in Nashville back in August his award-winning speech about accepting and embracing your identity. It was definitely a powerful speech that made him a clear winner. And now we're in for a treat as Cyril will be sharing with us his storytelling techniques that help him win his first international title. The insights we will learn today will also empower us to bridge cultures and connect with audiences around the world. Why do you think this is important? In this age of globalization, it is essential that we have an appreciation of the different cultures that will lead to better understanding and connection for an enriching experience. At this point, I would like to thank and commend the leaders of UPLB Learning Resource Center, Los Baños Toastmasters Club, and Division K, headed by Director Rica Villadolid, for organizing this awesome event. Kudos to everyone for making time to attend this empowering event. Let's continue to celebrate our differences, connect, and learn together. Back to you, Toastmaster Cheryl.
Thank you so much, distinguished Toastmaster Jazz. And now let's listen to the leader who steers the ship of hashtag Team LRC. I'm very proud to present to you the director of UPLB Learning Resource Center, Assistant Professor John Mervin L. Mbate.
Thank you very much, Ms. Cheryl. To all of our friends from the Toastmasters International, to our distinguished guest speaker, TM Cyril Jr. Dim, to our dear UPLB students, guests, and participants in today's webinar, a very pleasant day, evening, or afternoon to all of you. The past 2 years have made us accustomed to live in isolation, both in the literal and metaphorical sense. Although we have remained connected through social media, our manner of talking and engaging with other people has been severely affected by the habits we have formed through the past 3 years. Before, we were sensitive to the effervescent quality of conversations, being attuned to the slight changes in facial expressions of the person we are talking to their side glances, the shaking in their voice, and all of the other nonverbal gestures that would prompt us if the conversation was heading towards the right direction. But now our online interactions seem to transpire in a rather faceless environment. In virtual spaces, we literally talk to avatars of ourselves. And what used to be natural reactions that happen on the go are traded to calculated interpersonal behaviors, such as clicking the thumbs up or laughing buttons, even if in the actual world, our nonchalant disposition reflects otherwise. The fact is, we now live in a complex infosphere where behaviors are informed and performed within a network of connections anywhere they may be in the world. One simple action in social media may provoke a butterfly effect that can reach to other people living in the other side of the planet. The online space has become a melting pot of various individualities, motivations, actions, and cultures. And any attempt to escape it or to exist outside of it is impossible. Hence, in today's time, the maxim, we cannot not communicate, continues to remain relevant and informative as our thoughts, interests, and actions are seen as part of a network of interconnected individuals and groups with their own unique stories and cultures to share. Today's learning session, brought to you by the UPLB Learning Resource Center and Toastmasters International, aims to encourage and empower individuals to make good use of our power to connect and tell our stories through public speaking. In a highly mediatized environment, it is important to think of public speaking in terms not only of its form and substance, but also of its role in bridging differences. After all, in spite of the changes in the media we use nowadays and the communication habits and behaviors we perform, the power of speech and communication remains to be potent and useful as it has been thousands of years ago. We invite you today to look past the duality of communication. Don't just see it as either a means to leave an impression or as a way to express one's thoughts. Rather, recognize it as a powerful tool to dialogue, to bring different ideas, stories, and cultures together. Through the insights from our distinguished speaker, we hope to inspire you today to become more effective communicators. All of you come from different backgrounds, and your presence today or tonight means that you are here because you see the practical value of communication in making our lives more meaningful. May it be because you want to be better reporters in your classroom exercises, or you want to be better managers or project leaders at work, or if you want to become better scientists or scholars who want to share your knowledge and technology to communities who need it the most. We hope that you'll wake up tomorrow with a renewed sense of confidence, not only in the art of public speaking, but in yourself as well. As someone who has a huge part to play to usher in an inclusive, equitable, and peaceful world that we all aspire for. Thank you, everyone, and let us all have a meaningful and worthwhile webinar together.
Thank you so much, our director, Sir JM. Now, I hope you were inspired from the speakers or from the messages of our exemplary leaders. Thank you so much for listening. And thank you so much, Sir JM and distinguished Toastmaster Jazz. Now, moving forward, let's have a short energizer. If you have been attending our webinars, you know what to do. But for those who are new to the platform, it's very simple. First, open a new browser and go to www.menti.com. And then next, use the code that you see on your screen, which is 28381296. Then answer the questions. Let me also share my screen so that we can see the live results of our Mentimeter. All right, let me just quickly. All right, so I hope you're seeing it. The first question is, where are you watching right now? So is it the morning or afternoon or evening there? From all over the watching from Zoom. Yeah. That's what my son is actually, you have seen my son. When I'm actually doing webinars, I will say, where are you watching right now? And he will be saying and shouting, on my computer. So via Zoom, that's right. At home, Binan Laguna, where are you? In the Philippines, let us know. From your laptop, that's right. From your cell phone, probably. All right, it's evening there from your iPad. That's okay. Morning, Balayan, Batangas. Is there anyone from abroad or other countries? All right, Philippines, Metro Manila, Nasugbu, Batangas, Los Baños, Laguna, very far from us. Where else? At home, Philippines, Laguna. Okay. Bye-bye, City Leyte. Hi, good evening to everyone from Bye-bye City, Santa Rosa. Where else are you from? Paranaque. Okay, Davao City. Okay, Philippines, still from Philippines. UPLB, Bulacan, Valenzuela, Calamba. Wow, all right. So from all over the Philippines. But I've seen from our registration, we have audiences or participants from other countries like Myanmar, India, US, and Canada. Okay? All right. Thank you so much. Keep them coming. Now, the second question, this is just a sort of a background for our resource speaker, right? So what do you think causes your stage fright? According to some research, these three are the major causes of stage fright. So on your case, what causes your fear of public speaking or your stage fright? Is it making mistakes, fear of the unknown, or the audience opinion, or all of them? So let us know, okay? So far, we are seeing here on our screen all of them, okay? Making mistakes, fear of the unknown, and the audience opinion, which is actually right. I can relate from all of you guys because I also fear making mistakes and fearing the unknown, what will happen if I make the speech, and also the audience opinion. So far, we have 178 answering the Mentimeter in our question. Let's just wait if we can reach. Is that all? 179? Are there any other? 181? Okay. Let's see if we can reach 190. So far, it's still all of them, okay? All of them are making you or causes your stage fright, making mistakes, the fear of the unknown, and the audience opinion. All right, 192. Maybe 200. Keep them coming. Keep them coming. And okay, 199. And one more, 200. All right. So final is 142 or 142. All of them causes your stage fright, making mistakes, fear of the unknown, and the audience opinion. Once again, thank you so much for answering our Mentimeter and for participating in our energizer. I hope you're energized. Okay. Now, because not everyone can join here in Zoom and somehow our Facebook Live has ended. So later we'll set it up again. And not everyone can turn on their cameras. We encourage you to take a selfie while watching this webinar and share it with the thread posted on LRC's Facebook page. Share your takeaways during this webinar by answering the question, what makes one a confident and powerful speaker? And use the official hashtags of the webinar, which is hashtag Bridging Cultures and hashtag Team LRC Toastmasters. All right, this is it. We've now come to our program's most anticipated part. Are you excited? Are you excited, guys? Let me see your emojis and your reacts. Let me just check. All right, so many hearts. Thank you so much. Are you guys ready to take your public speaking to the next level? In Filipino, G ka na ba? Are you game? If you are G or if you're game, type G. Type G in our comment section. Let me see. Are you G? Okay, you're G. That's good. That's very good. Okay, so if you're G, so are we. To introduce our renowned master speaker tonight, let me just now turn over the Zoom space to the past Division K governor and now assistant Division K director for program quality of District 75, none other than Distinguished Toastmaster Maria Luisa S. Joven. Distinguished Toastmaster Louie, over to you.
A pleasant evening, my fellow Toastmasters, and to each and every one of you in this intercultural, intergenerational, and notably youth webinar audience. I am very honored, and it's my pleasure to introduce to you our acclaimed speaker this evening. Our esteemed speaker recently won the Toastmasters International World Championship of Public Speaking held in Nashville, USA during the Toastmasters International Convention last April, besting 33,000 participants from 144 countries with his speech of self-acceptance entitled Ndini, meaning this is me. Zimbabwean by descent, Toastmaster Cyril graduated from the prestigious Wrocław University of Science and Technology lives and works as a software engineer in Poland. He is a passionate public speaker with more than 10 years of competitive and non-competitive public speaking. He has avidly explored various avenues of the spoken word, including theater, stand-up comedy, sports commentary, and events hosting. Toastmaster Cyril has 2 national speech championships tucked under his belt. Not to mention, he had been the district champion for speech evaluation, improvised speaking, and humorous speaking, and a 2-time European continental champion of the International Prepared Speech Contest. In one of his interviews, Toastmaster Cyril disclosed that his speeches are about life experiences, lessons, failures, and struggles. And he speaks to inspire productivity, self-acceptance, and mental resolve. Indeed, Toastmaster Cyril is a man who, with a result-oriented work ethic, has truly mastered the principle of research, implementation, and presentation. His life and youth showcase the power of communication to move the world. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in warmly welcoming the 2022 and the youngest ever world champion of public speaking, Toastmaster Cyril Jr. Dim.
Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you are. I would like to start by saying, on behalf of my club here in Wrocław, Poland, my girlfriend Camila, and the entire team that has helped us to bring this presentation to you, Komusta. As has been highlighted, I am Cyril Jr. Dim, the fortunate winner of the 2022 World Championship of Public Speaking. And I'd like to start as well by thanking our hosts for today for organizing this and making sure I'm here with you guys. I'd like to give a big thanks to Los Baños Toastmasters Club, who reached out to me soon after the championship happened and made sure that I could be here. Division K, District 75, members of faculty UPLB, Toastmasters guests, students, friends, all protocol is observed. Culture. Culture is an interesting, albeit effective way to become a better speaker. In fact, some would argue that culture might be one of the easiest ways to become a better speaker. When I started speaking, speaking was all about getting free attention. I discovered, look, there's a crowd who will actually listen to me talking, and you know what? They will actually clap afterwards. When I started going on stage, it was rather self-centered, all about me. And then I started competing. And so all of this suddenly became attached to trophies, to medals. A couple of years back, I started trying out for the World Championship of Public Speaking. And my whole mentality, my whole approach towards speaking, it changed. And it is the knowledge I've acquired over these years that I hope to share with you today. Because ever since I started trying to compete for the World Championship, speaking has been about connecting and delivering real value. And when it finally worked out in Nashville, speaking became all about giving that value from a place of true identity, from a place of self, from a man of culture. Now, many people would wonder, how can I do that? How can I connect? How can I use my culture to connect? What is it about my culture that can make me a world-class speaker? Or you know what, sir, let's not even talk about all that. How can I start speaking well to begin with? Maybe you've asked yourself these questions. Maybe you've looked at yourself and said, me, a speaker, not exactly. And you know what? You're not alone. Many people at some point in their life have felt that they didn't have the stuff to become memorable speakers. But I find that many people conflate being a good speaker with being a good presenter. And I'm here to say that's not always the case. Being a good presenter, a showman, is an entirely different thing from being a good speaker. A good speaker seeks to connect. And I'm sure you agree with me, that's not all about presentation. I mean, think about the last time you spoke to your best friend. Maybe you were sitting over coffee. Maybe you were having a drink somewhere. How fluently does your best friend speak? Are they using their hands right? Are they there pausing every two sentences? More likely, your friend speaks rather naturally. He stutters, he or she stutters here and there. They forget a phrase, their eyes wander. But in that imperfection, there is still connection. And I believe you can use that wisdom, wisdom from a conversation, in your daily speaking. The first question I try to answer when I think about how you can become a better speaker is, what is your speaking style? And I know many people have stopped at this point and thought, well, what is my speaking style? I find that public speaking in itself is based on how you speak in conversation. Of course, you've got to factor that up a bit because you're talking to a bigger audience. Then you've got to remove a few elements that make you unnatural or that make you difficult to connect with. Over the past few years, I have learned and I've been teaching people what I call the formula for discovering your speaking style. And I'm going to share with you a presentation that's going to go through a few of these elements. All right. So your speaking style, as we've said, is your conversational style, factored up to the size of the audience, removing overly casual elements. And you can look at each of these things here and understand why they're important. When you're speaking in front of people, you want them to feel as though, even though they're a part of an audience, they have been spoken to individually. And that's why it's important to keep our nature of speaking conversational. But because you're speaking to more than one person, that conversational manner has to be scaled up just a bit to account for the number of people in the room. And then, of course, those elements that make you seem overly casual, or you can work on those to make sure that people treat the message that you're delivering with the gravitas it deserves. Now, how have I done this over the years? Well, one of the exercises I did in Nashville, which I found very effective, was before we went on stage, before we went for rehearsals, we went downtown and we were talking to absolute strangers, and my exact pitch was, look, I've got a story, just a 7-minute story that I'd like to tell you. It might change my life. You have 7 minutes to listen to me. And the goal of that exercise was to make my entire speech, these 700 words, feel like a conversation. And if I could present that same speech, the speech I would give on stage to nearly 1,000 people, to one person and make it feel like a conversation, then I can definitely say I've checked off that conversational aspect. The audience size, of course, has to do with how you use the stage, how you use your voice. But what I find very interesting is that third part, the overly casual elements. When you're discovering your speaking style, you're going to have to go through a long period of observing how you speak. Now, I find that many people find the sound of their own voice irritating. Perhaps you find the sound of your own voice irritating. Do you listen to a recording of yourself and think, goodness me, I sound so annoying. I want to punch myself in the face. Well, it's very interesting that you are your heaviest critic. And so as you observe yourself speaking through recordings, through videos and media of the likes, you become more aware of things you do subconsciously but come off as unnatural. Now, I know for a fact that when I'm speaking, I have a tendency to smack my lips, to say, and I would have never realized that had I not gone through the videos. And in fact, I'll be honest with you, when I'm nervous, the tendency to do that does creep up. In fact, if you watch my winning video on YouTube, you can find a few moments where the nerves get the better of me and I fall back to that old habit of mine. But of course, we're going to talk about that later, because many people as well have this idea of, should I present perfectly? How can I do it without making a mistake? Well, friends, all speaking, all public speaking, whether you're speaking at a university, at work, in Toastmasters and beyond, it starts with understanding your speaking style and how you speak. And that is a function of observing how you speak in conversation, making it big enough for your audience, and making it presentable by removing those overly casual elements that make it difficult to listen and to follow. But going onwards, people wonder what material they're going to use in their speech. And probably you've asked yourself this question too. what am I going to talk about? The currency of any memorable speaker is the story. And right now, perhaps, we're going to stop this presentation and I'm going to tell you a story. I can stop sharing. There we go. So this is a story of the first speech I ever gave. The first speech I ever gave was part of a homework assignment, and it wasn't based on the fact that I was a good speaker. The first speech I ever gave, I gave because my teacher thought I had good grades in English. And so he walks into the class, he looks around and he's like, there's going to be National Tree Planting Day. I'm going to need you to write a quick speech about trees. We'll talk about the specifics later. And I went home and I wrote this as homework. In fact, I'll be honest, I wasn't very willing. I thought there's 50 kids in this classroom and you want me to do extra work? So I wrote only two paragraphs. In fact, it was about 200 words. And when I look in retrospect now, that speech is possibly the most important speech I ever gave, because that was the speech that made me discover that, well, maybe there is something in public speaking for me. But that speech is a bit of a tragedy for me, because I don't remember much of what I said. I know I said something about climate change. I know I said something about fruit. I know I said something funny, but I can't tell you the specifics. Now, juxtapose that with the idea of telling a story. Have you ever watched the Titanic? Have you watched The Lion King? Have you watched Forrest Gump? What does Hollywood do when they want to convince us to think a certain way? When they want us to love a certain character? They tell a story. And it's so impactful that you will watch The Black Panther. And because the story is so compelling, you will go out and you will buy a hoodie, you will buy a t-shirt, you were sold onto the idea of The Black Panther. And it's interesting that you could use the same idea even within industry. And here's another story. One of my high school teachers, I'll never forget him, he took me for biology. This one lecture, which was by far my favorite, we spoke about the aging process. Of course, because this was high school, we were discussing DNA, how it works, genealogy, and all that. And he broke away from the syllabus for a second, and he started telling a story. And he said, you know what? If you look at a strand of DNA, right at the end, they are what we call the telomeres. And when DNA replicates, these telomeres are less perfectly reproduced, which means each time the DNA replicates, your telomeres are less and less perfect. And because of that, you get old, I get old. Now, we're researching this and we're thinking as biologists, if we can find a way to make DNA replication closer to perfect, if we can slow down the degradation of telomeres, then we can combat the aging process. And you can look this handsome, or maybe not you, Cyril, but your friends can look this handsome for a much longer time. Friends, I work in IT. I don't work with DNA every day, but I will never, ever forget that lecture, because he told a story of how they do it in industry and how this simple concept of DNA replication is valuable, is important. Now, maybe you're talking to students, or maybe you're given a pitch. It can be much easier to connect when you're talking to people in the language of your experiences, in the language of your past, in the language of your successes, in the language of your failures. And this is really what we try to tap into in my winning speech. We try to tap into the idea of what have you learned in the life you've lived? What are the mistakes you've made? And from all of that, how have you grown? Matthew Dix, who's a huge influence in my storytelling bit, he says that any story is about 5 seconds. The 5 seconds when something in your life changes significantly. The 5 seconds when you look at her and you say, she's lovely. I want to spend the rest of my life with her. The 5 seconds when you say, I will never buy from them again. The 5 seconds when you say, this is home. The 5 seconds when you say, I should leave. And any stories about that. So if you can paint a picture of those 5 seconds when something about you changed, all of a sudden you become more human and people really want to connect with you. But then you're probably thinking, well, Cyril, I work a 9-to-5. I wake up the same time each day, ride the same bus, never been in an accident, never been arrested. I've never been drunk once. I think my life is rather boring. Where can I find stories? Where can I find stories that inspire people? And it's difficult when you listen to a TED talk, for example, and this person is saying, we had to jump out of a burning building and there were helicopters and there were speeding car chases, there were police and guns. And you think, I've not lived a life like that. How can I tell that story and connect? Well, let's go back to the presentation here. We're going to talk about something that I found very valuable. And it's the idea that you don't necessarily find stories. Stories are all around you. The sad tragedy of it is that we tend to miss these stories. They're lost to time. They're lost to memory. If we were to play a short game right now, first, last, best, worst, and I gave you a prompt, I am certain that you could tell me a story. If I said first, horse, and you have to tell me a story about the first time you saw a horse or the first time you rode a horse, that is a story. When I say worst, and I say worst ending, you could think of a time when a job ended, a relationship ended. I'm pretty sure you can tell me the story of when you left high school. That was a part of your life ending. All of us have these stories, but we tend to lose them to time and to memory. So what can we do to make sure that we're ready when the opportunity presents itself? Well, I started an exercise not too long ago, and it's the idea of collecting my stories and reflecting on them, making sure that when the opportunity presents itself, I can go back to that bank of stories and pick a story that fits the situation. Matthew Dix calls this the homework for life. Many Toastmasters call this their little storybook. But you can do this way. At the end of each day, you could think about what the most profound story is that you could tell from your day. What is the most interesting thing that happened in your day? You could write just one sentence. It takes just 5 minutes. And it's interesting what this exercise does. As you think about stories from your day, you are reminded of stories from your past, and you're amazed at how much value, how much gold is sitting in your childhood, gold that is lost to time, gold that is lost to memory. So friends, if you want to become better speakers, more impactful speakers, we now know that it's important to discover your speaking style. Your speaking style needs to be as conversational as possible, yet as dignified as possible. It's your conversational style fixed to the size of the audience minus the overly unnatural or overly casual behaviors. And then we go a step below and say, to be an impactful speaker, your most powerful tools are the stories you can tell, because stories create emotional investment. And when people are emotionally invested, they're going to listen. And most importantly, they are going to remember. Now, what about my Toastmasters friends? What about people who are saying, okay, Cyril, what about the contest? How do we apply all of this to a contest? Well, my mentor taught me something very valuable, and it's what I'd like to set as the baseline. Speaking, public speaking, is not about looking good. It's not about looking larger than life. It's not about us. Speaking is not about looking good. It's about being real. And so we go back to that concern that many people have. What if I can't say it perfectly? What if I'm not a showman? What if it just doesn't look good when I do it? Well, friends, that's not the point. The point is, when I listen to you, I need to believe that you're telling me the truth, not just the truth, your truth. And how you apply this to a contest is that if you're going to go in it for the best result, make it so that you win because you deserve to win. And how do you do that? How do you deserve to win? It's a couple of contestants in the room. All of them want to do well. All of them believe that they deserve to win. What can you do to separate yourself from the rest of the crew and be a memorable and obviously winning speaker? Well, a few things that we started doing. habitually over time, or to prepare in good time. Now, it's the temptation to start writing the speech when contest season begins. There's a club contest in 2 weeks and 3 weeks. Well, okay, I'm going to write my speech. I'm going to rehearse it the week before. And as the contest progresses, I'm going to refine my speech, and hopefully it's going to get better. We were sitting backstage in Nashville, and we were talking amongst the semi-finalists. And it was interesting, the things I heard. I've had my speech for 2 years. I wrote this speech when I joined Toastmasters. When did you join Toastmasters? 25 years ago. Well, friends, if you're going to do well in the contest, I hope you see that you're in a really stiff fight where everybody has invested their most precious resource, their time. A couple of years back, we took on a crazy challenge and we wanted to participate in the Polish championships of the humorous speech contest. The twist being that I speak less than impressive Polish. Let's just say when I speak Polish, Polish people ask me if I'm okay or if I'm having a seizure or worse. And so we needed a lot of time to write the script. What I did is I wrote a basic script in English, and I was so sure this is just an experiment. I wrote a few words in English. And we sat down, my girlfriend and I, and we translated it to Polish. And then we looked at the script and we thought, you don't sound like this when you speak Polish, Cyril. You make a few mistakes. You make a few adorable mistakes, is what my girlfriend calls it. I don't believe her. And we factored those mistakes into the speech. But now here came the interesting part. I needed to actually know how to say this in Polish with correct Polish pronunciation for the entire 7 minutes without having a seizure. And so the entire process from scripting to the club contest took about 7 or 8 months. That speech existed that long before the contest. And I'm happy that it produced such fruitful results. When it came time for the contest, I felt readier. The second point, how you can, we go back, win because we deserve to. This is a lesson I picked up from David Henderson. He's a world champion as well. And he said the best way to be a better speaker is to be a better person. The best way to be a better speaker is to first be a better person. And I translate this to say that you cannot disseminate value that you don't have. You cannot sit or stand in front of an audience and try to teach them how to figure out life when you yourself are struggling in that regard. Very often, when speakers try to take this approach, it doesn't come off as authentic. It's very difficult to believe. It's very difficult to connect to. So maybe you want to ask yourself off the stage, do you have a reading culture? How many books do you finish a year? Because that means you're growing. That means you're learning. That means you're becoming bigger as a person. You have more value that you can offer each time you speak. And you can ask yourself questions such as physically, how well do you take care of yourself? You know, the old saying, body and mind. If you're taking care of yourself, it shows to the audience that you value yourself. Health is one of the most precious things that we have. And when the audience can readily see that you're taking care of yourself, and when you know and feel and understand that you're taking care of yourself, it is easier to speak from a place of value. Now let's talk about preparing right before you go on stage. Because I'll be honest with you, whether you've been speaking for a day, a month, or a decade, that is one of the scariest times ever. I was sitting here listening to my introduction and I was thinking, it's a lot of pressure. He has done this, he has done that, and I won't lie, I got a bit scared. And right now, as I'm speaking to you through this camera, I can't help but be a bit nervous. So if you feel that, before you go on stage, rest assured you're not alone. And it's certainly quite a few people who have to contend with nerves before they go on stage. But what if I told you that before you go on stage, the fight is no longer with finding a story. It's no longer finding your speaking style. It's not even the other speakers. Before you go on stage, the fight is with yourself. One thing I noticed that I did as a matter of habit is that I treated my presentations, I treated my speeches as an obligation. Remember that story of the speech about trees? I treated that speech as homework. So I wrote my 200 words, I gave the speech, and I was waiting for a rating. Over the years, I've realized that it is really important, crucial even, to treat your speech as something sacred, as something valuable. That piece of work that you're about to give to the audience in that moment is the single most valuable thing in your world. And when you think of your presentation that way, suddenly you stop thinking about yourself and you start thinking about this gift that you have for the audience. I have a small exercise that I do before I go on stage each time. I talk to myself. And in that conversation, the first question I ask myself is, what is stopping you from walking out right now and not giving this presentation? What is so important about this presentation that you have to give it? What's stopping me from logging out right now? It's a few hundred people that I've only met for a few seconds in my life. Why is this speech important? And the second thing I do is I remind myself of the preparation. Now, remember what we said, you want to feel that you deserve to do well in that presentation. One of the most important things you have to convince yourself is that the universe or the heavens or God or whatever it is you believe in, you have to convince yourself that all of that is conspiring to help you succeed. And how do you convince yourself of that? Or you convince yourself that you're prepared. You convince yourself that you're ready. You remind yourself of the preparation it took to get to this moment. And I remember I'm standing backstage in Nashville and I'm thinking of how many times I have said that speech. I am thinking of the faces I saw in downtown Nashville, total strangers that I said this speech to. I'm thinking of all the work that has gone in behind the scenes. And that sense of preparation, it strengthens you. It makes those nerves calm down, if not just a little bit. And the last thing I tell myself in that conversation, well, I remind myself of who I am. Remember what we said, that good speakers are constantly working to become more valuable? Well, in that moment, when you're nervous, before you go on stage, you are allowed to brag to yourself, to remind yourself just how much more valuable you have become over the past month, over the past year. When you start viewing yourself as qualified to deliver your own speech, in that moment, the nerves calm down just a bit more. Remember, friends, when we're speaking, it's not about looking good. It's about being real. And in order to be real out here, we need to feel real in here. So how can you deserve to win? Remember what we said. Give your speeches time to mature. A good speech is not written. It is rewritten. Work on yourself to become more valuable. You cannot give value that you don't have. And last but not least, every time you're speaking, treat that presentation as something sacred, as something valuable. What you do before you go on stage, before you walk into that boardroom, before you go in front of those students and lecture, it conspires to build the greatest value that you can give in that presentation. So maybe you're a lecturer right now and you're thinking of the next lecture you're going to give. Stop for a second and think just what it is you're doing. You are giving those students their future. Tell yourself that before you step into that lecture hall. Tell yourself that you're literally handing someone their future or their dream. You are a part of that. And as a lecturer, when you remind yourself of that, you walk into that room and you're ready to give value. Maybe you're ready to go and give a pitch to sell something. Remind yourself how much work it took to build this product. This product wasn't made yesterday. It is the product of years or maybe months. You know best. Remind yourself of the work that has gone in behind the scenes. And you walk into that boardroom ready to give a pitch, knowing that you are speaking from a place of value. Now remember, though, the core of this is culture. How can we do all this? How can we bring all these technical aspects? Finding your speaking style, finding speaking material or stories, working on yourself as a speaker. How does the cultural merge happen? And how can we take our cultures to the world? Well, I'm sure you agree with me that culture can be many things. Culture can be strange. It can be confusing. But it can also be very interesting. The difference is in how you treat culture. Many times when people treat culture as this strange thing that we're going to sideline so that we speak in universal terms, we miss out on the real value. I found a few very practical tips that help you to bring your culture to the rest of the world. We're going to go back to that presentation. And we're going to speak across all cultures. The most valuable thing that you can have, or the most practical thing that you can think of, is to assume that nobody knows the culture you're talking about. They don't know where you're from. They don't know what you're about. And it's your job to make them understand. When you think that way, it affects the way you speak. If you're speaking to someone who has no idea what you're talking about, you're more deliberate in the way you explain. And it's easier to connect that way. If you watch the World Championship speeches, I love Alexandre Matt. He speaks French. And for a while, you're listening to him speaking French. You're listening to him saying French terms, speaking of recipes that him and his French-speaking family have indulged in. But at no point do you think, well, what is he talking about? I don't know that. And what is it that Alexandre is doing? And what is it that so many speakers do from all around the world to make you interested in their culture? Or they speak this language. I call this the language of where I'm from. Think back to that biology teacher. He spoke this language perfectly because even though he was speaking to a group of students, he had no idea where we were going in life. I ended up as a software engineer. A couple of my friends ended up as lawyers. We didn't have the same academic culture, shall you say. But what did he do? He said, where I am from, in the field of biology, we study this and we're trying to do this and we're trying to achieve this. And this is how it's working out. And you can do the same thing when you're talking. You can use this very practically in my community, in my family, amongst my friends, amongst the academic community. And it's interesting that the moment you speak that language, the language of where I'm from, people become less confused, less dismissive of culture, and they become more curious because naturally you're thinking where you're from, what happens. And we tried to apply this in Dini, the winning speech. We thought for sure if we were going to bring Africa to the world, we were not supposed to assume that people would understand. Rather, we were supposed to assume that people knew nothing about our culture and it was our job to bring the culture to them. And so it's interesting. One of the opening lines you find in that speech, in Zimbabwe or where I'm from, we speak Shona. And in this beautiful language, we have a very important word that I'd like to share with you today. Friends, think of those things that you do in your family, in your community, in your culture, and translate them to the language of where I'm from, because automatically it sparks curiosity. And the moment you speak that language, people feel like they've learned something when they walk away from you. Or if they know what you do, where you're from, they feel, I'm quite smart. I know about the Filipino culture, even though I don't live there. So the next time you speak, try and find room for this language, the language of where I'm from. Now, the next way you can bring your culture to the world, of course, is to speak universally. And I find, I'm sure you do as well, that there are some emotions that are universal across all different cultures. Regardless of where we're from, we are going to feel excitement, empathy, resolve, and so on and so forth. To the left, you will see highlighted in green a few of those emotions, and you will find some of them are typically negative and some of them are positive emotions. But I'm sure you agree with me that they are universal. But you could also say to me, well, Cyril, the emotions to the right, they're also universal. Everybody feels pity, anger, hatred, or pride. And I'm sure you're starting to get the point that when you speak in terms of emotions or when you connect or appeal to emotion, culture stops mattering and culture stops being a war against connection. Why I put those emotions to the right is that in any presentation, regardless of which culture you're speaking to or from, it doesn't work in your favor if people start to pity you. You want them to feel empathy, but you don't want them to pity you. You don't want to speak from a place of anger because anger is rather personal and it's very difficult to make everyone feel angry with you. So, of course, you can disclose that you felt angry, but it's very difficult if you're speaking and appealing to anger. It's very difficult as well to appeal to hatred. And as a speaker, I hope you're never speaking to appeal to hatred. And last but not least, pride. Appealing to pride, really, we're proud of ourselves, is rather selfish. And it's very difficult to connect, unless, of course, you want to encourage pride in our community or something of the sort. But generally, the sense of self-centeredness is difficult to appeal to. But looking at this in a more umbrella sense, appealing to emotion, it erases the need to look at what culture you're coming from. But going onwards, this is the part I was really excited about because I wore traditional African attire for the first time in my life this year. I grew up in Africa, very easy to find. People dress like that all the time. I think, and this is the great idea, let's call it that, that I'd like to bring with you, that all too often we think of elements of our culture as gimmicks. We think of our clothing as outfits and costumes. We think of our behaviors as gimmicks. And so we water them down just a bit. Remember what we said about value, the value you give out here? We said it needs to come from in here. And it's very difficult for me to bond to your culture if I don't see that pride in your culture. Now, I'm not saying we should all dress like this. Well, we can dress how we please. The point of this illustration is that we need to stop viewing elements of our culture as gimmicks and recognize them as important pillars of who we are. And it can be very small things. Maybe in your culture, you don't clap, you bow. Maybe you curtsy, or maybe you dress like this formally. I wish less people would look at these as costumes and more people would look and say, that's a suit just from the Middle East, or that's a suit just from Africa. If we start to exhibit pride in our culture by the way we present ourselves, by the way we speak, if we stop trying to be mainstream, shall I say, we give value to our culture. Mainstream became mainstream because the owners of that culture gave that culture value. You can give your culture value. And I'd like to make it very clear as well that I'm not saying that we don't give our cultures value. I'm giving a challenge or an opportunity for you the next time you speak to the world, to speak to them not as a generic member of the world, but as a Filipino or a Canadian or someone from Japan, giving your culture the esteem it deserves, and I'm pretty sure you recognize this, but we value it too. And we walk away from your presentation feeling, if not anything else, that we learned something. We will walk away thinking, not just that I heard a talk about ABC. Suddenly, this talk has an identity. I heard ABC from someone from DEF. And it's interesting that we've got many examples of people who have done this very successfully. We think of one of the most popular examples, the Dalai Lama, giving his TEDx in his traditional monk garments. And you're thinking, what is it that makes it a talk from him? It's not just his words. Of course, his words build, but it's the way he presents himself. He presents himself as a member of a community that deserves recognition. And because of that, he becomes emblematic of the entire community. Lecturers, students, speakers from all over the world, you represent something much, much larger than yourself each time you speak. You represent a family. You represent a community. You represent a city, a province, a country. You represent a people. The next time you speak, imagine how much value you could be giving by acknowledging that you belong to these people. Elements of our culture need not be gimmicks. Our traditional clothing need not be outfits. It is who we are. And if we as speakers demonstrate pride in that culture, we make it easier to bridge cultures all over the world. The world is hungry, not just for speakers, but for speakers from around the world. And it is your opportunity each time you speak to give the world a speaker from your part of the world. It all starts with how we view our culture and the esteem we give to our culture each time we speak. So I invite you as speakers, as holders of the future, to bring your culture to the world in the way you speak, in using the language of where I'm from, even demonstrating how your culture behaves, how your culture dresses. That is a telling testament to all of us, and it's a lifelong lesson that there is a world outside the suits and ties, that there is a world outside corporate mainstream, that there is a world where you are speaking from. Now, friends, having considered all this, the last thing I'd like to talk about, well, I'm sure you've wondered about this. My culture probably means I speak a different language, and because of that, when I speak in English, I sound different. Well, Cyril, what can I do about that? What can I do so that I sound more, you know? Well, friends, an accent is evidence that you speak another language. And I've got friends from the United States who say, Cyril, it's amazing that you speak two languages. Here in the United States, we speak English and bad English. Forgive my accent. An accent is simply evidence of that you're speaking one language with the rules of another language. So the first thing I'd like to make absolutely clear right now is that an accent is nothing to be ashamed of. It's nothing to shun. It's not about having a different accent or a mainstream accent. It's about being audible. It's about being easy to understand. And in whatever accent you have, you can still be audible. Of course, this is a function of lots of rehearsals. And if you go back to the story of how we write speeches, giving your speech time means that you're going to rehearse for quite a while. And as you do that, you will become more audible. And as you're more audible, your accent stops mattering. If anything, your accent is just another building block saying you are from a different culture. So friends, when we sit and think about what we've learned about being a speaker or being a better speaker, we know that the journey starts with understanding your speaking style. It's not about looking good. It's about being real, which means your speaking style has to be rooted in your conversational manner of speaking. Of course, your speaking style can be refined. When you watch videos of yourself, when you listen to yourself, you become more aware of the things you do subconsciously. We now know that the currency of any memorable speaker is the story. The movies do this to us all the time, and billions are spent each year because Hollywood knows how to tell a good story. If you want to connect, if you want to be memorable, give them a story. And we now know that we can habitually collect stories, stories from our day, stories from our past. These stories remind us of more stories. We don't find stories, we recall stories, and we recount those stories. Ensure that none of your stories are lost to time and memory. We now know that convincing, compelling speakers deserve to be convincing and compelling, and that's because they give their presentation time. The next time you're speaking, if you're in the habit of preparing in the 11th hour, try preparing in the 10th hour, then the 9th, then the 8th, and you will find that the quality of your delivery dramatically improves. We know that compelling speakers are also valuable people, and we can think of many practical ways to become more valuable. Developing a reading culture, taking care of our physical health, learning from other people, all these things make us more valuable because we can't give value that we don't have. We need to be like sponges that absorb the value and give it out each time we're squeezed. We now know that the cultural elements of our person can be brought into any presentation. We have the opportunity to use the language of where I'm from. Assume that people know nothing about where you're from, and it's your responsibility to make them understand. So if you're speaking in industry, in our industry, where I'm from, and help them understand the value of how you do things where you're from. If you're speaking from your family perspective, cultural perspective, national perspective, the language of where I'm from makes people curious. And after listening to you, they feel they have learned something, or they think that they're smart for knowing what happens where you're from. We now know that our culture needn't be heard alone, but our culture needs to be seen. We need to stop thinking of elements of our culture as gimmicks. We need to stop thinking of our traditional clothing as costumes, because that defines where we are from, where we have come from, and who we are. And if we treat those cultural elements with reverence, we make the world realize that there is a world outside the suits and the ties, that there is a world outside corporate America. Bring your culture in all its elements, behavior, dressing to the world. And if you behave in such a way as to say, this is normal where I'm from, people look at you and feel they have learned something, or in the very least, they feel they're smart for knowing it. Last but not least, your accent. It's not evidence of any undoing. Your accent is evidence that you speak more than one language, and that's great. It's not about having a different accent in order to connect. It's about being audible. To be audible, we give ourselves time to practice. And as we practice, refine, when we go on stage, we make sure that all elements of our delivery are fine-tuned. Now, to close, I'd like to remind you what I said there, that we all have a responsibility to give our communities to the world, to say to people where I'm from, we do things this way, and it has taught us these lessons. You are the gateway to your culture and all the wisdom contained within that culture. Please, do not deprive the world of it. Help us to learn you, to learn your people, to learn your community, to learn your family by giving reverence to those elements of your culture, by speaking the language of where I'm from. You will be surprised at how much people bond in those learning opportunities. You will be surprised at how much more proud you will feel of your culture. And we will all greatly benefit when we build these bridges across our culture to show each other how we live and how we have learned the way we live. It's our responsibility. It's well within our means. And with practice as powerful speakers, with practice, deliberate practice to become better speakers and communicators, I believe all of us as students, as members of faculty, as Toastmasters, as speakers at large, as communicators in general, we can bring this value in its greatest light. All it takes is that deliberate effort to build bridges, building bridges across cultures. one speech at a time. Thank you. Or as the Filipinos would say, salamat.
Yes. Virtual clap for TM Cyril, Junior Dim. Oh my God. The best way to be a better speaker, first, be a better person. If you want to bring value, be valuable first in here because you cannot give what you do not have. Wow. I'm very stunned. Thank you so much, Toastmaster Cyril, for those helpful tips and insights. It's as if you're just speaking right through us. It's as if you know us very well. Thank you so much for those words. They will undoubtedly assist us in becoming more confident and effective public speakers. So guys, what are your major takeaways? Feel free to share them in our chat and comment sections. And if you have any questions to Toastmaster Cyril, he will address them after our 5-minute break. So in the meantime, you can grab a cup of coffee, take a walk, or enjoy the videos that we have prepared for you. So stay tuned in because we will be right back right after this short break. All right. A deliberate pause is the ability to calm our bodies and focus our minds. And yes, we are back once again for the Bridging Cultures, One Speech at a Time, a Master Speaker webinar featuring 2022 Toastmasters World Champion of Public Speaking, Cyril Jr. Dim. With a short break, we hope you've gathered your thoughts and digested what Toastmasters Cyril shared with us earlier. So many takeaways, so many valuable lessons, so many tips to take in. But right now, we will now proceed to the question and answer section or portion. I'd like to hand over the Zoom space to our Q&A moderator to lead us in this segment. Let's please welcome the Associate Dean of the UPLB Graduate School and a member of Los Baños Toastmasters Club, Dr. Ronilo Jose D. Flores. Toastmaster O'Neill, the Zoom space is yours.
Good evening, Toastmaster Cheryl, and thank you for introducing me this evening. And of course, we would like to thank our guest for tonight, distinguished Toastmaster Cyrene, the 2022 World Champion in Public Speaking. And, you know, it was such an exquisite speech, and I agree with some of the comments, or most of the comments in the comment section, that they were able to pick up a lot of different lessons, a lot of different tips in order for them to improve on their public speaking skills. And most of our, and I heard that a lot of our students are here tonight, and I'm sure they have a lot of burning questions, or maybe they could ask some tips from our distinguished guest tonight. So let us start with a question and answer portion. I hope DTM Cyril is ready for some questions from halfway across the globe. Okay, so we'd like to encourage our members or our participants to type in their questions in the chat box. We do have a question and answer box, question and answer function. And we also have, you may also raise your hands. Our technical team will help me in allowing you to speak if you would like to verbalize your questions to our guests this evening. So let me start with the first question. I think it's written in the question and answer box. You talked about the need to have a conversational attack in your speeches in order to generally connect with your audience. But Julius Cruz, who is also a Toastmaster here in the Philippines, would like to ask whether or how to balance, how do you balance the need to be conversational in your speech in order to connect with the cultural nuances of the audience that also need to be taken into account. I believe you've mentioned a lot of some tips a while ago, but perhaps maybe you can expand a little bit on this and share more.
Okay, so the question is on how we can balance the need to be conversational with the cultural nuances of the audience that we're talking to. Well, that's a really good question, Julius. I think the basic starting point is finding common ground. There are things that are universally accepted across all cultures, but even still, the mere effort to try and do something considered welcome in a different culture, for example, it's recognized. I'll give you an example. You're speaking to a Japanese audience, and in that culture, they bow quite a bit. Now, perhaps in your culture, you don't bow as much. You're doing it just once to acknowledge that you recognize the differences in culture is enough. And I don't feel you're bending too far away from your natural conversational style of presentation when you do so. In any case as well, when people present, I feel there's an overflow of the gestures, the movements and all that, things that we typically wouldn't do if we were sitting and just having coffee. So it's good to always remember those elements that would otherwise be a bit too eccentric for a presentation.
Thank you very much. I forgot to unmute myself for one bit, but that was such a good, but I can clearly relate because I've been to, I lived in Japan for quite some time, for 7 years. And I really do relate to the fact that a lot of cultural nuances such as bowing is actually part of their, you know, a part of their normal body biomechanics, as I would say. But there are other interesting questions here. And one thing maybe also interesting to our participants tonight is your style or your technique or some tips in reducing the ums and the ahs. Because you know in Toastmasters you do have ah counters and counters and all those fillers. But I believe our students would like to know, how do you train yourself to not overdo the ums and the ahs?
That's a really good one. So this is a question of how to increase fluency when you're speaking. And the first tip I give to anybody I'm working with or coaching is slow down. When we slow down, we reduce the likelihood that we're going to make a mistake. And the second thing we need to learn is the ability to stop. Now, we do this exercise, and maybe you can think about it with students, where we say, come on stage, count to seven, then say your name, then stand there for 20 seconds. Don't say anything more. And if you do this with somebody who has just started speaking, you realize just how uncomfortable many people are with silence. And silence makes some people nervous, but the actual opposite is true. Silence can be useful and silence can be very powerful in a presentation. Case in point, when you want to be more fluent. So another idea is between ideas or between statements, put a pause. So slow down, stop sometimes. And then if you want to proactively work on fluency, one thing that I did for years was reading out loud. So you take a text and it's a novel or something, you read it out loud and read it with a bit of life as if you were narrating the events and so forth. Over time, it works to make you more fluent with your words. So slow down, learn to stop, and practice reading out loud. It helps a lot to make you more fluent.
I remember when I was in college, I used to study for my exams, and I used to read my notes aloud, and my mother always had to knock on my door and said, can you please tone it down a bit, you're too noisy. But anyways, it just brought me back to my college years. But some of our college students would like to know, so there are lots of questions coming in here. All right, so how do you engage an audience, a heterogeneous audience maybe? So not all audiences would have the same mindset as we are as public speakers, but there are certain audience members who do not have the same mindset as we are, especially if we're talking about topics that are very contentious, very controversial. How do you attack this? How do you create a mindset, or how do you try to speak without trying to become too argumentative?
Right. That's a really, really important question. And thank you for that question. Now, I'll tell you what I do, what I've done. And this also works, especially in stand-up comedy, for example, where you know you're going to say a joke, but you don't know if you're going to ruffle feathers. And I'm going to stretch out the experience. Generally, you have only one opportunity to set a first impression. And if the first impression you set is of somebody who thought before they spoke, then more likely than not, people are going to be less resistant. Of course, people might think whilst you're speaking, but it's less resistance. And that starts from the moment you walk on stage. And it's another thing, another small, seemingly insignificant exercise that I did with my mentor, and it helped greatly. It's doing everything rather slowly at the beginning. So you walk on rather slowly, take your time, compose yourself, and don't feel the need to start speaking immediately. And how this was explained was that non-reactive people appear more confident, and they appear more grounded, and they appear more well thought out. And we see this all around in a movie, for example, the suspicious guy is the guy who speaks really fast and he's all shifty and looking around and doing stuff like that, as opposed to the powerful guy who is grounded, slow, thinking before he speaks. takes moment for some. So for example, just that mentality alone, starting on a calm and composed note, which says, I don't feel any pressure. I don't feel intimidated, even if you do, it helps. Now, the second thing, to try and attack a contentious topic, use humor. It was Mark Twain who said, if you want to tell people the truth, make them laugh or they'll kill you. So it's very important to try and approach the hard topic from the humorous aspect. I try and use the laugh, cry method, which is let's have fun. Let's talk about something serious a bit. This is what I feel. And then let's close it off. The last thing I would recommend, especially with these contentious topics, is you need to make a clear separation between your opinion and the facts. As long as you're stressing, this is what I believe, this is what I think, this is my opinion, you are well within your rights. And people become less aggressive when they listen to you from the perspective of, oh, okay, his opinion. We may disagree, but he said that's his opinion versus the facts. So that's how I would approach that.
Well, thank you. Related to the issue of or the challenge of speaking about contentious issues is public speaking that may be related or correlates to the right of to the right to free speech. You know, there's a question here from an anonymous attendee, and he says that he feels that like it's hard to remove social, political, and cultural issues from public speaking and their threats to speakers. You know, there are certain parts of the world wherein if you try to say something that is true or real, then it might be a little dangerous for the public speaker. For example, sometimes, no, there are cases in the Philippines, no, when it is seemed or it is dangerous to speak up against certain political figures as it may, you know, cost dreams and lives. Given that situation, he says, do you still suggest to always take on the mic and not run away, even if it may cost you some, you know, it would lead to some unfortunate events later? Or if ever you're going to run away, what are the things you would do to make up for that?
Well, I can deeply relate to that question. And honestly, I'm going to say that's really important. I grew up in Zimbabwe during the Robert Mugabe era, where you could not say anything about the president, where people disappeared, where people were abducted. I remember Trevor Noah, comedian, when he first popped up, we were all excited about this South African guy who was really funny. And in one of his sets, he was like, in my tour, I'm not going to go through Zimbabwe because you can't make jokes about the president there. Of course, he made more jokes about it that, you know, normally if I get arrested in Zimbabwe, my president should write a letter or call and get me out. But I don't know if my president likes me. You know, he was making it all funny, but I grew up in that era where it was dangerous to speak your mind. And here I will honestly say this question is larger than public speaking. This is not a question of should I speak or not. We go back to what we said, that good speakers are people of value. And value is a question of what you believe in, what you would live for, and what you would lay down your life for. So I wish I could give a concrete answer and say, yes, go ahead and speak. The only thing I can say with certainty is if you believe in it, if you live for it, and if you're helping people, then you have a voice. Public speaking is not just about entertaining and winning shining trophies. People who hold the mic, they hold influence. They influence how people think, how people live. So it is our responsibility as speakers to talk about the things that matter. It is our responsibility as speakers to talk about the future, to talk about our future, to talk about the future we want for our children, to talk about the way we're living right now. But the question of whether you should do it or not is much greater than public speaking. So to that, I will say, how much do you believe in it? And the answer lies therein. thank you for asking that. That's a really important question.
Excellent. Because, you know, times like this, in the era of fake news specifically, it's very easy to hoist and post something online that might not be true. And perhaps, you know, we can, as public speakers, probably some of us would deem or consider being public speakers as a, you know, it within our task to say the truth and to be real. Thank you very much for the response. And on another topic, Gabriel John De Leon, who's also a teacher here in the University of the Philippines, wants to ask, and he asseverates that it's a good feeling to deliver a speech while you are in the zone, right? Maybe all of us can relate to this. There are certain times when it's very easy for you to construct certain thoughts and to organize your feelings and emotions, but there are certain days wherein you can't seem to find the right words or can't find the right sentences. His question is, how do you handle mental blocks, or how do you handle moments wherein you seem to lack the focus or the flow for speech writing or creating your speech?
That is an excellent question. Again, a universal question. I had this one day where I was going to present four lines, very easy to remember. It was one of the fundamental human rights on the day of human rights. The president was sitting right behind me. I went on stage, blocked out, couldn't remember them for the life of me. The golden rule for any presenter: the show must go on. So on days like that, where, for example, you've got a mental block, it's not your best day, I think the most important thing becomes just getting the message across. And of course, that comes from understanding what the message should be. So if you're there on that day to say every human being has the right to do A, B, C, then on that day, do just that, nothing more, nothing less, because you're drawing from energy that you don't have. So it is important to remember. And to that end, I'm really happy that Toastmasters International gives us a wealth of training, because we have table topics or the improvised speech contest or session. And that's the idea of it. No prior preparation, and the topic can throw you this way or that. I remember I gave someone a topic once. The topic was the inside of a tennis ball. And I saw someone thinking it was hilarious, but that trains you for days like that, days when the creative process is not working and you need to draw on something to get the message across. That training in improvised speaking, it can greatly help you to come across well, even on the rainy days.
And speaking of coming across even on rainy days and trying to really give a good imagery perhaps of what you're trying, would like to say, there's another question by DTM Cruz, DTM Julius, who's with us tonight. He says here, when sharing stories through a speech, do you think it's enough to just relay the story through a narrative or perhaps a third person point of view? Or would you recommend to include snippets of dialogues in order to recreate the scene behind your stories?
Storytelling, that is an important question. And I love talking about storytelling because I've been studying it so extensively. And I felt that for a while, the movies were tricking us after I realized just the tiny things you can do to make a story sell. And the one thing I understand is words have value and you can make them more value. You know what they say, the lower the supply, the higher the demand. If there's a lot of dialogue in any story, he said, she said, then he said, and then she said, the words lose value. But if you put in a narrative, you know, you have a few asides where you tell, this is how I felt in this moment, this is how I thought. And then you come back to the narrative, and then you give us just one dialogue. That dialogue becomes kind of a cornerstone of the story, and it becomes really important. And you can think of many conversations in movies that have used this. The conversation with Mufasa, the Lion King, and his son, Simba. We all remember that for the short dialogue. Remember, who you are. That's all we remember. And that dialogue becomes super important because it's not too long, because it's not, but dad, and back and forth. So stories need dialogue, but the best stories treat dialogue as a climactic, very important part where words were said that you will never forget. And that gives the dialogue more value. So dialogue is important, but just enough to keep it valuable, not too much of it.
And just so to keep the dialogue enriched, we'd like to invite another person to come in and engage in our dialogue while our participants are thinking of their questions. May we invite on the virtual space, Assistant Professor Linus O. Plata, for some reactions on the topics, and after which we'll go back to discussing some questions from our participants on Zoom. Assistant Professor Linus.
Thank you, Dr. Flores, who is also a good friend, a senpai, and you know, nothing less than a public speaker par excellence himself. So thank you, Dr. Flores. Well moderated. Hi, Cyril. Well, I was only given actually 2 minutes, and I wish 2 minutes were 2 weeks, okay? Because there's just so much to, you know, to babble on, so many, you know, a plethora of insights indeed about public speaking. And I'm sure that the 608 participants in our Zoom meeting room are, you know, pumped up about, you know, speaking in front of a crowd. I'm sure they're going to be more confident and inspired. So all I want to say in the next, well, I think I've only got a minute, is that as a communication professor and as someone whose, you know, life purpose is to also empower others to speak with more confidence, I thank you, Cyril, for reminding us to own our story, to just embrace who we are, which includes our cultural identities. You know, I'm reminded of the late American poet Maya Angelou, who said, "I come as one, I stand as 10,000. You know, she wrote that on behalf of her African American descendants. So you are here with a particular set of cultural ethnic identities, and you carry with you not just, you know, your little ego, but your entire lineage. You are a representative of your cultural group, and you've got to do them, you know, proud, right?" And so you mentioned also earlier about, you know, some people getting insecure about the way they sound. And as a public speaking coach myself, I have my own share, Cyril, of insecurities, one of which is actually I don't like how I sound. And you know, I wish I could sound like Matthew McConaughey and have that Southern accent with all the yodeling and stuff. But that's not how I sound. I sound more like Conan O'Brien. Well, for good and for ill, I'm a big fan of his. And all I'm saying is, this is what we've got. And we're going to step onto that stage, bringing with us our own peculiarities, our own weirdness, our own quirks, our own insecurities. And the message to the audience is, here I am standing in front of you. You take it or you leave it. And what helps with the frayed nerves, I think, Cyril, is what I keep telling my public speaking students, which is that important message that you're conveying to a crowd is paramount. You don't make public speaking about you. It is about the message. It is not about you. And that kind of mindset, I think, takes away all the distraction, all the attention away from you and toward the message that you are going to share with your audience. So one of the things I often tell my students is that public speaking is an act of giving. And one last thing before I give back the floor to Dr. Flores is that it's important to be vulnerable. We are not here telling people to actually get rid completely of our fears, but to manage them, master them. And it's important that we admit our feelings and say something like this for the 613 people in the room. You are free to say, before you give that speech, you are terrified about giving, "Yes, I am scared. Yes, I have some frayed nerves, but I'm gonna do it anyway." I'm gonna do it anyway. And people who have emerged as victors in history are those who have decided, despite the fear, that they're gonna do it anyway. Because to quote Mark Twain, courage is not the absence of fear, but the mastery of it. Thank you, Cyril. Thank you for sharing with us your gift of public speaking. Back to you, Dr. Flores.
Wow. I think that will pass as a prepared speech for Toastmasters Club.
It was an impromptu.
You should well join the Toastmasters Los Baños Club.
I'm part of the community, Kuya. Yeah.
Well, that was Professor Linus with his comments. And I think those are really valid and important observations, don't you think?
Absolutely, absolutely. Couldn't have agreed more. I do agree, especially what you said about managing the nerves, because that's something we've been taught for a while. Whether you've been speaking for a day, a decade, or so forth, those nerves are not going to leave you. At some point, you're going to start questioning yourself. And this is what we said right before you go on stage sometimes. The biggest fight is with yourself before you actually step out there. Well, I do agree that the nerves, managing them is the key, not getting rid of them. I find that many times when you're at the point where you're like, I'm not scared, that's your ego speaking. Typically, difficult to connect with that. So absolutely, absolutely couldn't agree more with the assistant professor there.
And sometimes the nerves give you a little bit of a kick, right? It puts your toes on edge. And sometimes it can be good. It can push you to do better. And I think we've reached the penultimate portion of our question and answer portion. We do have a lot, a plethora of questions in our question and answer chat box, and we'll collect all of these questions and we'll perhaps send you, and hopefully we'll provide some answers and send it to our participants. But before we let you go, DTM Cyril, can you please tell us your final words or final, bits or nuggets of wisdoms that you can share with our participants in this webinar?
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's been an absolute joy. Something in me said that if I was ever going to visit parts of Asia or travel more to the East, that I definitely want to land in the Philippines. I've got friends here who are Filipino. Awesome, awesome, awesome. They cook really well. I'm burning inside a bit that it's virtual, but the future is ours, and there's absolutely nothing stopping us from having sessions like this one day in the future. I am absolutely impressed by the amount of effort that went into making this happen, and I cannot thank enough the team at UPLB who helped to make this happen, Toastmasters in Los Baños, Toastmasters Club, Division K, District 75. When the offer was made, the support was unconditional. And it reminded me of the system under which I learned to speak, a system under which the support was unconditional, a system under which, as long as there was a will, people made the way. And this has been one of my greatest tools in learning how to be a better speaker. It's not so much the hours I put into speaking. It's not so much the hours I put into writing or reading books, but it's the time I've spent with people. People who've taught me what connection looks like. People who've allowed me to see another person thinking, because that's what public speaking is in the end. It's creating connections, and those connections create memories. Those memories last a lifetime. They can change lives. So friends, for the many of you who have come here today, no doubt showing that you've got an interest in becoming a better speaker, I hope you take this away with you, that it's not about being a showman, it's about being a human being first. The world needs a lot of that. A lot of people we can look at and say, there goes another human being. I'm not alone. Somebody else is experiencing that. Somebody else has survived that. Somebody else did that. I can do it too. And I hope you go into this world of speaking with that goal in mind, the goal of finding people who may be going through things you've gone through, or people who want to learn from a human being. you can approach public speaking very practically. And honestly, I can guarantee you that the results, well, the results are endless. The rewards are unrelenting. And more than anything else, you will be an effective communicator. You can go through public speaking as I did in the past for the accolades, for the recognition. But as we've learned in the small talk we gave and from the assistant professor, it's not about us. We are simply conduits of something that is much larger than us, that message that we want to give to the audience. And I hope you go into every speech you give thinking that it's not about you, it's about them. I realize the importance of this talk because I'm not just talking to Toastmasters. I have educators here. I have students here. I have people from all walks of life who recognize the importance of speaking. Now, to the educators, to the professors, the lecturers, and so forth, I'd like to remind you how heavy the responsibility you bear is. Many of these students will choose their paths in life based on the passion you exhibit when you're teaching them. Many people become programmers or doctors, of course, because they love the science, but also because they had a very, very passionate teacher who convinced them through their way of speaking that there is work to be done in this industry. I envy that you hold the future in these students that you're going to be talking to in each and every lecture. Do you remember that as you go through this, delivering the lecture as deliberately as possible, you can not only transfer the information, you can connect and you can make these students take this information personally. To the students, I say, well, as you know, you're the future. The future needs a voice. I won't forget that one question about places where it's dangerous to speak. And if I can speak right now, I will say it is not right. Of course, our freedom ends where another person's freedom begins, but the common denominator is freedom. And as students and as holders of the future needs a voice. And the time you're taking right now, learning how to communicate, how to impact, how to connect, it may serve a much better future for yourself and for those that will come after you. And many people would appreciate. So I urge you to persist in deliberately learning to be a better communicator and in speaking not to look good, but to sound real. To Toastmasters and everybody else who has joined us in this meeting, this lovely meeting where we have learned so much, I hope you see now that to be a good speaker, one doesn't need to climb Mount Everest. We're not saying it's easy, but we're saying it's not impossible. The common word here we've used is it needs to be deliberate. The key to success is consistency. And through organizations such as Toastmasters, the resources that have been made available by the university, Los Baños, and so forth, and the educators we have here, I hope you see that there is a plethora of support to help you to find your voice, to help you to bring out those stories, and to help you to present those stories to the world. And in closing, I will say the cultural aspect is what gives your message flavor, is what gives your message the vibrance that it needs to connect. Before I went on stage in Nashville, I met a stranger. This man was in my life for about 7 minutes, and he made me stand in front of a picture, and he wanted to take a picture of me, not with me. And I thought, well, this is rather weird. And he showed me the picture and he said, look at the picture behind you. It was a picture of the first Black university that was built. And the students who built that song would sing Swing Low, Sweet Chariot to raise money to save that university. And that man looked at me and he said, you are more in touch with these people than any of us could ever be because you never left home. Remember that as you go on stage, you're speaking for these people too. And it made me realize that all of us are speaking for someone, our families, our communities, our countries, the cultures we come from. Please do not deprive the world of the beauty that is your culture. If not anything else, It will remind us that we are not the center of this world. There are many other people out there who are living differently or living beautifully. Own your culture. This is you. This is me, Ndini. It's been an absolute honor. And this meeting we've had today will stay with me for a really long time. Thank you very much for having me and forgive me for going over time. Thank you.
Thank you once again, distinguished Toastmaster Cyril. Where we come from, we don't just say thank you, we say maraming salamat po. I turn over now the virtual space to our host, Toastmaster Cyril.
Thank you so much, Toastmaster O'Neill, and a big thank you, Toastmaster Cyril. I still have goosebumps when I hear your story regarding the picture. It's as if it's your destiny to be there, to bridge the culture, and to you're really such a gift, just like what DTM Betsy said. So thank you so much. Now, without further ado, I'd like to call on the president of the Los Baños Toastmaster Club and an assistant professor as well here in UPLB to summarize and provide valuable insights into our session. Let's please welcome Toastmaster Rogelio P. Panuelos Jr. Toastmaster Rog, good evening.
Good evening. Thank you so much, Toastmaster Cyril. Hello, everyone. Magandang araw po sa lahat. And Cyril, maraming salamat. I feel privileged to have been given the chance to offer my attempt in synthesizing the salient points from Cyril's talk. By taking this role, I feel that on the one hand, I was given space to share with you how I experienced today's talk. And on the other, I feel that I've been given the challenge to render in language in such a short period of time the nuances of this beautiful experience. So let me try my humble attempt. At the outset, Cyril stressed the importance of seeing public speaking as a way to connect and to bridge. He generously shared with us how he characterizes public speaking. First, he told us that public speaking is not divorced from everyday life. Perhaps we often associate public speaking with big crowds, microphones, but Cyril reminded us that we just need to learn from the wisdom of our daily conversations. We need to build on our conversational style and be more considerate of how our audience speaks and listens. We need to be mindful of our overly casual elements and try our best to minimize them. Second, Cyril also shared with us that stories sit at the center of public speaking. Cyril encouraged us to use our language of our experiences, our successes, and our failures. He encouraged us to be more human. Perhaps that's the greatest takeaway that I'll be having it this afternoon. That public speaking is just you existing, being you, being more human, and sharing your own stories to the world. He encouraged us to build our story banks. What a great phrase to remember, right? Let's collect our stories. Let us reflect on them. Let's share our stories to our captured audience, to the world. Third, Cyril also stressed that speaking is about authenticity and growth. Let us speak from a place of value, and let's give our speeches time to mature. Often, we tend to associate speaking with the manners through which we can convey our message more effectively, but sometimes we just need to realize that we need to speak from our core. And isn't that beautiful? That speaking is also learning about ourselves and the way we connect to other people. Cyril also told us that we need to own our culture. We need to bring our culture to the world. And how can we do this? By speaking the language of where I'm from. that speak the language of where I'm from. I'm speaking from this community. I am a part of this family. These are the nuances of my group. I am from the Los Baños Toastmasters Club. I study communication arts. I am a part of the biology faculty. So let's listen and let us share what we can based on our experiences. Let us put prime value to our lived experiences. Cyril also acknowledged the importance of giving culture the esteem that it deserves. Let's not see wearing our, let's not associate gimmicks with our cultural elements. It's time to revisit that idea and perhaps to just consider that it's not gimmick, but it is how I present myself to the world. I also enjoyed how Cyril talked about accents and embracing, our native tongues. This is how we sound. Let us not try to sound like the other people. There's nothing wrong with our accent. So let's just treat it like it is a cultural element that I can be proud of. And finally, I think Cyril made a very great statement when he said that you are the gateway to your culture. Do not deprive the world of it. Powerful phrases. I am the gateway to my culture. How dare me to deprive the world of it, right? Friends, students, Toastmasters, guests, I think what we have experienced today now is Cyril ushering us to this space where we can imagine possibilities of a future that listens to and learns from the many cultures that we find ourselves in and the many cultures that we collectively create. Thank you so much again, Cyril. We've learned a lot from you. Maraming salamat. Back to you, Toastmaster Cheryl.
All right. Thank you so much, Toastmaster Raj, for that very insightful summary and valuable insights from PM Cyril's or Toastmaster Cyril's talk for tonight. Now let's proceed to the awarding of the Certificate of Appreciation to our master speaker tonight. To give a vote of thanks, let me turn over the space to the Program Quality Director of District 75, Distinguished Toastmaster Nino N. Sepulveda. Sir Nino, good evening.
Good evening, Sharia. Can you all hear me?
Loud and clear.
Can we also, Zoom Master, can we also spotlight Cyril? Madayaw, Cyril. From where I come from, it means warm greetings. I'm from the South, by the way. My heartfelt appreciation to our world speech champion for public speaking, Cyril Junior Dim, for being so gracious with his time visiting District 75 Philippines. And in behalf of District 75 and the entire team, we prepared a certificate of appreciation for your valuable time. Zoom Master, can we please share it as I read the citation? Can you also spotlight Cyril? One moment. Certificate of Appreciation is awarded to Cyril Junior Dim for serving as resource speaker during the webinar entitled Bridging Cultures, One Speech at a Time, held via Zoom and Facebook Live on November 12, 2022. Given this 12th day of November 2022 at the Learning Resource Center, University of the Philippines, Los Baños College, Laguna, Philippines. Signed by Division Director of Division K, Veronica Villadulid, Director of Learning Resource, John Mervin Embate. We also have the President of Los Baños Toastmasters Club, Rogelio Panuelos Jr.
Thank you very much. This is beautiful. Thank you so much.
And, you know, Cyril, they are still working on perfecting DNA so I could look good like you. Joking aside, thank you for reminding us to take pride and value of our culture, that is our identity. And I would like to commend also Los Baños TMC, UPLB Learning Resource Center in partnership with Division K Toastmasters, that is in Calabarzon area in the Philippines, for hosting our program tonight. Toastmaster Cheryl.
Thank you so much, distinguished Toastmaster Nino. All right, so once again, thank you so much as well, TM Cyril, for that. Now, we'd like to take this opportunity to, hold on, okay. Finally, I'd like to recognize in the Zoom space the Division K Director of District 75, none other than Toastmaster and soon-to-be distinguished Toastmaster, Veronica G. Villadolid. Tiderica, good evening.
Hello, good evening, good morning, and good afternoon, everyone. All good things must come to an end. That's according to Geoffrey Chaucer. From this webinar, we learned a lot of good things, inspiring words, a lot of realizations, and aha moments, as if we would not like to end. But we have to go back to our own realities with our families, work, community, school, back to the daily things that we do in our lives. But as we go back, we bring with us a new perspective, a better way of becoming a better speaker, being confident in ourselves, in our own uniqueness as a person. The beauty of this webinar is that we are from the different parts of the Philippines, from the different continents of the world, with different profession, culture, and tradition. But we all can relate, and we were all inspired by one person from Zimbabwe, Toastmaster Cyril. Thank you so much, for you have taught us that the best way to becoming a speaker is first to become a better person. In such case, it is hope that the 600 plus persons who have attended this webinar will create a ripple effect in inspiring others to become better persons also. Thank you, Los Baños Toastmasters Club, for spearheading this webinar. Thank you, University of the Philippines Los Baños Learning Resource Center, for partnering with us in this great endeavor. Thank you, District 75 officers, District Director Chas, Program Quality Director Nina Sepulveda, for your support in this program. Thank you, Division K Council and Area Director Joan for the teamwork. Thank you, everyone who joined this webinar. Let us be the best version of ourselves as communicators. After all, the fight is not with others. And according to Toastmaster Cyril, the fight is with ourselves in our quest to be a better person and better communicator. Indeed, we are fortunate to be Toastmasters, as we were given the opportunity to meet people from the different parts of the world whose passion are public speaking and leadership. To know more about Toastmasters, we are inviting everyone to join the District Convention, Toastmasters District 75 Convention, this coming April 28th to 30 2023 at Marriott Hotel. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you so much, Toastmaster Rica, or Didi Rica, as we call her. Now, we'd like to take this opportunity to capture this meaningful and precious moment with 2022 Toastmasters World Champion of Public Speaking, Cyril Janjardim, and the rest of LRC Toastmasters team. Let's seize the moment. I'd like to ask Mr. Joshua Michael Jonas, the head of the events technical team, to lead us in this photo opportunity. Can we all open our cameras and take a picture with Cyril?
Okay. Sir O'Neill, Sir Linus, Sir Raj. Okay. Is everyone's camera already on? Can't open. Let's wait for everyone. Sir Roy, you may want to join us. Okay, pa.
Hindi po, kayo na lang po. Thank you.
Okay. Ready? Right. Everyone, smile. 1, 2, 3. All right. One more. 1, 2, 3. Smile. And last one, just to be sure that I got the photo. All right. Give me your best smile. Ready? 1, 2, 3.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
I think I like Cyril's post. Ate Cheryl, let's do the Korean heart.
Heart one.
Okay.
Okay.
So, all right. Ready? Korean heart. All right. Everyone, Korean heart. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Smile. All right. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you so much, Josh. Okay, so now for the evaluation of this webinar, I know you've been waiting for this, especially those students who were required by their teachers to attend tonight. So answer the evaluation form after this webinar to receive your e-certificate of attendance. And once again, your comments and suggestions will be deeply appreciated by our team, hashtag Team LRC and Toastmasters. The evaluation link will be sent also to those who successfully registered for the event. Kindly be reminded that the link will be up until 1 p.m. on Monday, or you can quickly just scan the QR code you are seeing on your screen and be directed to the evaluation form link right away. And we hope that we all gained inspirations and valuable insights from our speaker this evening. Okay, you may screenshot this as well if you want, so you can have a copy of the link to the evaluation form. Right, and also it will be sent to your email. At this point, we would like to recognize our team for this event. This would not be possible without the help of hashtag Team LRC and also the Toastmasters team from the technical team, publication team, the program committee, including our SAs, our student assistants here in the Learning Resource Center. So first off, we'd like to recognize the team for the program committee. And then the technical team as well, headed by Josh, our University Research Associate Program Committee. Thank you so much for joining us tonight and for making this event possible. All right, so Program Committee and then the Technical Committee, headed by Joshua Michael G. Jonas. And then the Invitation Committee, headed by Sir Joel or Toastmaster Joel Bihania. And Team LRC, of course, Sir J.M. Mbate, yours truly, and our SAs, Clarice, Sophia, and Wendon, and all the rest of our team members. All right, that's it for today. That ends our webinar. This has been your moderator, Cheryl Hermosa Ebron. Let me just share this short reflection from Cyril's words tonight. Public speaking is not about looking good. it's about being real. It resonates so much to me because I know that we all have stories to tell, but what we should focus on is on the message and focus in here where it would be coming from. If we wanted to be good speakers, let us be a good person first. And with right practice and strategies, all else will follow, one story at a time, one speech at a time. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. Stay safe, stay happy, and God bless, and bye everyone.